I'm Liz Shannon Miller. I'm TV editor over at Indiewire.com, and I'm very happy to be joined by Charlotte Newhouse and Jillian Bell. Yes, that's right. You applaud, please. Cheers are good, too.
Thank you.
And you guys have been great about giving us these pre-supplied questions. It makes my job a lot easier. And because I think this question is the one that a lot of us have, we're just going to start off with it from our friend Jack Scollard. He would like to know.
Give it up for Jack.
Woo! But our friend Jack Scollard would like to know, how did you originally get involved with this series?
We just didn't answer and just stared at each other for 10 minutes.
Man, I don't know.
We met at the Groundlings and wrote a sketch together and decided we were writing partners. Mm-hmm. And then after doing a few runs of shows over there, we were like, we should do this professionally.
Yeah.
Maybe people can see it more than 99 people in a theater. And so this was the first thing we came up with. We sort of did it as a cheap way to shoot something. We're like, how can we put something in one location and make it attractive to a network? And that's where the idea of house arrest came from.
That's all right.
she's just here to back me up and tell me I said the right thing.
In terms of you start with house arrest, when did the idea of your character, Charlotte, come in?
We didn't have like who was gonna play what.
Right.
We just sort of like, oh, the idea of house arrest is very sexually attractive to us. And then we sort of like played around with it and improvised, and we just sort of fell into the characters we ended up playing.
So there was no like specific moment where you were like, I wanna play Jean versus I wanna play Billie?
It was a huge fight.
Yeah.
No.
No, we started, we didn't originally, I think, know who would be who, but as we sort of wrote out a huge Bible for it, and then we wrote the pilot. And as we were sort of practicing dialogue, we kind of fell into those roles.
I mean, in terms of finding the characters over the course of the season, did they feel fully formed when they came together, or do you feel like they became richer as characters the longer you were developing the material? Well, I mean, of course that's true, but you get what I'm saying.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, that happens naturally, like you were saying. It's like we have pieces of them, and then as you start doing, like we started writing the web series, we wrote the pilot first, and then as you write the web series, you're like, well, would they do this? Would they do that? And so when we had our writer's room together, it was the first time we had other people chiming in and saying, oh, I had this idea that they could do. And it was the first time we were like, no, Billie would never do that. Or like, Jean's not that person. And we're like, you know.
Yeah, the Jean character they got right away, that the Billie character definitely grew and changed. And we got to know better as we tried to explain to writers, like, it's not a straight man as much as you want it to be. And
right.
That became like, that sort of got more developed.
Which is sort of why the episode, the second episode you guys saw, which is our third episode, is one of our favorites, is because you kind of get to see Billie be the one that's out of control and Jean sort of has to take the reins. So that was always fun for us. But even with Jean, like, they would be like, somebody walks in, she's just like doing this crazy sexual thing. We're like, no, she's not that person. Yeah, you know what I mean? Yeah. Like, she may talk about that, but I don't think we should see it necessarily.
That's fantastic. I mean, you mentioned the idea of being a straight man. Is that something that ever interests you at all?
Either one of us?
Yeah, either one of you.
Being a straight man. I think being a straight man is harder in a way.
Mm-hmm.
But it's hard because we come from a sketch background, so we're always like sort of inclined to play characters. I like straight men too. I like homosexual men. I like straight women. I like all omnisexual. Take it away.
Everything she said is true.
See, you guys are both being backup for each other.
Yeah, exactly.
And what for you working together, is there a core of, is it, what if you were to define like the core of your friendship, what would it be?
Of our friendship?
Yes.
Sexual attractiveness. No, that we both find each other really funny. I think Charlotte's very smart and I'm okay, smart-wise. We balance each other out.
That's the balance?
Yeah, the balance is...
We're friends because I'm smart and you're okay smart. That's how people become friends. I think we do really have a very similar sense of humor, like crazy similar, specific in the things we like. And we, because we're very different people, but we're like just super close and couldn't have, I think, more of a in tune comedic sensibility.
It's interesting watching the episodes because knowing that you guys created the show together and knowing that you've worked together for years, you know, your characters come at each other with such an adversarial relationship, especially at the beginning. I mean, is that tough to play?
No, I think it's fun. I mean, for us, we started out doing sketch and playing odd characters who didn't always like each other. So I think, you know, it's just like playing another character.
Does it ever release any actual tension between you two?
Oh, yeah.
Does it?
No.
No.
We actually really get along. Like, it's so funny. We'll do, like, a scene where we're just yelling at each other. We're like, that was so much fun. Yeah. Just give each other a hug. Yeah. It's really lame.
It's not awesome. How deep does that trust go? Like, is there anything you feel like you could say to the other person that would destroy everything?
I mean, with people in general, I guess you could always destroy any friendship. We could say horrible things to each other right now, but we're never going to. Yeah. Is this the moment you want to have where we just take each other down?
Hate each other?
Because we'll do it.
I don't know. I'm just. I apologize.
No, we're kidding.
That's so funny. All right. I want to go to another audience question because these are good questions, you guys. This is anonymous. And I think this kind of is what we've been talking about already. But from this anonymous person.
Give it up for anonymous.
Brave.
This person. This person would like to know, how difficult is it to pick a writing partner and make such a successful show? Such a successful show, by the way.
Oh, thank you, Anonymous.
I hope it's
I think that it's really, really difficult to find a writing partner that you gel with the way I think we do. From being at Groundlings, you write with a lot of different people, you know, and even someone that you might have, like, I love everything they do. Yeah. When you get in the room together, you might just not have that chemistry or that connection. Or someone that you don't necessarily love what they do, you have an immediate connection with. The thing you want to find is that person that's like, I love everything they do, and, like, I can write with them.
Right, and you can take it to a different level sometimes too. Yeah. Like, and it's funny too. Like, I'll be writing a scene with Charlotte, and I'll say, "I'm kind of thinking," and I'll say like one word, like, "I'm kind of thinking like a jewelry store," and she's like, "Yeah, like a mall strip and brown carpet and fake plants." I'm like, "Yes," and like it's so weird. Like, I haven't even described, but it's in my head, and then she has it. So it's very difficult to find that person
that sees something the way you do.
I feel like it's as difficult as like finding the love of your life. Aww. Really?
Even
sincerely.
If you're omnisexual.
Even if you're omnisexual and love homosexuals and heterosexuals.
Heterosexuals.
Yeah.
People who are bicurious, polyamorous.
You guys have brought up the Groundlings a little bit, and I just want to make sure, like, for anyone in the audience who isn't familiar with the Groundlings, talk a little bit about the training you got there and what it meant to you to be a part of that institution.
Well, it's a school. It basically was what I call my schooling. I went out there, I moved out here when I was 18, and I was like going to college for me. I basically learned how to improvise and write sketch, and Charlotte did too, probably, but I don't know.
Sorry.
and and perform, really. And so there's like four main classes that you have to go through. And if you pass each level, they can vote on you and ask you to be in the Sunday company, which is like a year and a half you have to be in that, and they make cuts along the way. And even if you stay in that for the whole time, then they can still be like,
still not get into the main.
Yeah, they can still be like, goodbye, thank you for your time and your money. And then we both got to be groundlings. We were both very lucky, and that's how we met. She was in it before me, and then I got in a little bit after her.
And so how much experimentation with other partners did you have over that time?
Sexually?
I apologize to you. That was not actually intentional, I swear to God.
I'd ridden with like a couple other people, but it never really took off. And with Charlotte, it was just like...
You do get to write with like...
Yeah.
Between Sunday company and main company, you get to write with like 50 different people. So it's a good barometer too. When you do like write with someone where it really clicks, you appreciate it.
You said is so true. Like, it's shocking you can be such a fan of someone and be like, we have the same
and
humor.
Yeah.
And then it's like you get together in a room and they're just like, I don't know, to everything you pitch. You're like, this is not going anywhere. But with us, it just kind of happened.
That's great. Lucky. You are.
Thank you.
Well, talking about writing your own material versus writing, not writing your own material. What's the difference in your relationship to, say, something like IDIOTSITTER versus something you've acted in where you haven't been involved with the writing?
It's totally different. I mean, it's with someone else's project, you're coming in, you're grateful to be there, you just need to know your lines and that's it, and not be the one that screwed up or ate too much catering.
So specific.
We'll talk about it later.
Okay.
We'll talk about it later.
And there's then a lot of catering. Like, it's hard to eat too much.
Like, again, another point. Huh? And then for this, it's like, this guest star did not show up on their first day of work because they got sick. What are we going to shoot today? Because every scene had them in it. This dialogue is not working, the scene's not working, and we're shooting it in 10 minutes. Like, what do we do? Wardrobe, every single detail is us. We're involved. And it's great because it's gotten to the point where people can sort of ask just one of us because we sort of share the same brain. Like, we will always, there'll be like a page of 20 different looks of outfits, and we'll both pick the same suit of what Kent should be wearing. It's very interesting. But yeah, I guess more details. You're more involved.
Sure. When you're actually in the scene, does it make a difference?
When you're
actually acting in the moment in the scene, does it make a difference?
Oh.
Oh, whether you've written something or not?
For me, it does.
Yeah.
I feel a sense of freedom a little bit more, because it's like if we screwed up or if there was a bad take, I'm very critical of myself if I do it on set, even if like Workaholics, as opposed to with IDIOTSITTER, I'm like, whatever. We're all here because we had an idea, right? Yeah. This is great.
Like, it's so tailored to you anyway, you know, that it's I think it's more fun. Yeah.
That's so I'm gonna turn to an audience question now.
Another from Anonymous.
Actually, no.
No?
It's Jack Scollard again, actually.
Oh.
We've got two from him. But his question is, how loose is the show format? How much is it scripted and how much is improvised?
It's, I think it's scene by scene. There's certain scenes where there's a lot of improv, and there's certain scenes that really can't kind of stray too far from what's going on.
And it's funny because a lot of the time when people are like, oh, that scene must have been all improvised, we're like, that one is actually completely scripted. We add a lot of likes and like, I just said it again, like. So people feel like we just made it up.
But we wrote it.
What's really interesting about it is that there's such a mix between some great wordplay, some great dialogue, and also you guys really go for the physical comedy. When you show up at work and it's a physical comedy day versus a writing a word comedy day, is there what's the feeling?
Regret. Major regret. No, I think like We both love physical comedy. I love it. But like, we'd be doing things and I'd be like, what the fuck did we do this? Like, why are we putting ourselves through this? Am I on a roof?
You were on a roof at one point. You're like shoving turkey on a table, like standing on a table.
I had to eat like a cold full turkey. And
they were just like, bring in the next turkey for the second take. And it was just like, oh my God, your face. And we had one where it was like we were covered in blood at like, and we shot it at 5 a.m. and it's freezing outside. We're like,
bugs.
Why? Why would we do this to ourselves?
I mean, is it something where you'll come up with a bit and you'll think it's really funny in the room and then you'll show up and actually realize you have to do it?
Yes. Yeah. And you'd think, I feel like for season 2, we were like, oh, if we get a season 2, we're not going to do that. And then we're going to be like, no, that was really funny. Let's go for it. And then regret it again.
We'd totally do it again.
I mean, I imagine you have a stunt coordinator on set for some of the stuff.
We had a stunt coordinator who, this is my favorite moment. There was like something where I had to lunge at Jillian. And he's describing to me how to like step and jump for like half an hour. And I'm like, okay. And then like the first take I broke my toe.
That was amazing. Was that the only on-set injury?
Yeah, I think so. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. I wonder if they're on. Sometimes I feel like these are non.
Gotta really hold it, hold your mouth close to it. Put your lips on it.
So, sorry.
Really put your lips on it.
You just gotta think of what other great American SAG actor has spit
put
on
their
this
lips
microphone.
On it.
And yes, I just referred to us as great American SAG actors.
I think I heard that the Danish girl was here yesterday.
What?
Gross. You said gross. I'm like,
I'm doing a great moderating job here.
You're great.
Yeah. I'm able to speak coherently. So for people who don't know, episode 4, which is aired this week, I believe,
yes.
Stars Channing Tatum, which that's a pretty good get.
Yeah.
How'd you make that happen?
I did 22 Jump Street with him, and we had some scenes together, but most of my scenes were with me and Jonah Hill, and so... we just liked each other as people, and I was like, we went to the premiere. She came to the premiere with me, and we cornered him on like a really big night, and we were just like, hey, we got a show. Will you please do it if we write an episode for you? And he's like, yeah, and he just kept saying, yeah, I'll do it. I'll do it even if it's bad, even if it's
he
not.
Kept
being
like, he kept saying like, even if it's not funny, and like as we were leaving, he was like, hey, even if it's not funny, and we're like, we'll try to make it funny.
I think. We'll try to make it funny. I mean, we made him do a lot of crazy stuff.
Oh, poor guy.
Yeah, you did.
He was David Bowie in The Labyrinth. He was dressed up as that. And the first day he came to set, we're like, okay, we're going to have you record a song in the style of David Bowie. And he's just like, singing in a room is so uncomfortable. And then I had sex with him.
You didn't. That part is made up.
As Jake Baruchel.
Yes, you did have sex.
I did. You thought I was just doing a bit?
Yeah. I thought you were like, he sang that I
had
sex
with
him.
Which is the worst.
So, in general, like you get in great, great comedy guest stars. Is it all just reaching out to friends? Or is there a casting process beyond that?
Reaching out to friends.
Yeah, we had a great casting director, and there was like a couple people who she reached out because we didn't know like Chris Klein was one that we were
wanted
to get Chris Klein, and we got him. Yeah, a lot of this is just being like, oh, I worked with this person or I know them through
a
friend.
Yeah, and we just know like from Groundlings, we picked a lot of people, and they're there are parts that were just like written with people in mind, which I think helped. And also we wrote parts for like, you know, like my friend Ting is not an actor and we made her be in it. And we just wrote her part.
She's so uncomfortable about it too.
She's getting better about it. She's like more proud of it now.
I want her to get recognized.
I know, I do too.
It'll probably happen. Yeah. So when it comes down to finding someone for a role you've just created, rather than writing something for somebody, what do you look for in an actor, especially as coming from that side as well?
We sat in on some of the auditions, and some of them we just were put on tape and then sent to us.
Oh, because Tansy was cat. Like we would even write, like we wrote a part for like Kyle Kinane, who didn't know us, but I just like him, and he like ended up doing it. So that was mostly what happened. But then. The Tansy process really was like watching a bunch of people.
Yeah, just watching their auditions. And I think a lot of it came down to like, what did they do that was sort of unique for us? Like there's some roles where it's just like, you need a guy, like in the funeral scene, the guy who's just like, he scared the shit out of me. You just want someone to play it straight, right? Like you want someone who just says it and nails it. But then there's others where you're like, with Tansy, we were like, we want someone who takes these one-liners and just makes like a little meal out of them, and you just get like a great laugh, and then you keep moving on to what the scene is really about. And Jennifer Lee Cox is just incredible, so we feel lucky to get her.
That and Stephen Root, who is just an incredible actor to imagine to work with.
Yeah, he was always super surprising, like the way he would say a line, like the versus the way it's written. It would always, I would never know how it was going to come out.
How important is that? Like, I mean, in terms of, you know, when you're in the process, when you're looking at other people to join you in the process, like how often do you want to be surprised versus get it the way you're expecting it?
I don't know. That's a good question. I mean, because sometimes you're like, oh, let's see what they do with it. And then there's sometimes where you're like, we had one moment, and I won't say specifically what, but where we just needed the actor to just say the thing and then exit, and it was really difficult. We couldn't get one take of it, and so stop laughing, and so we had to like do that through editing, unfortunately. So sometimes that can happen where somebody wants to make too big of a meal out of a moment that doesn't need it, you know. So it's hard. It's sort of like a gut thing. Like you sort of just have to feel it out. Like if it seems like this line was written to be a joke, then go for it and improvise and have fun with that. But if it's just like, here's the exposition and I gotta go, maybe do that.
I'm gonna go to an audience question now. Part of which we've already answered. So I'm just asking the first part. It is from Aaron for both ladies with a smiley face. And he wants to know, how much creative freedom do you get while creating the show? I imagine this is creative freedom in terms of what you get from Comedy Central.
We got a lot.
So much.
They were great. I mean, they were great producers. They sort of really let us do what we wanted. I mean, they gave us notes on everything, but if there was something that we disagreed on, they'd usually let us win.
Which is extremely rare. I mean, I've worked on other shows before too, where it's just like there's so many studio execs there and everybody wants to have their say, and you don't have that happen. So I feel like a network like Comedy Central it's very rare.
Yeah.
How do those discussions go? I mean, how much pushback do you have to give to make sure that you get what you're hoping for?
Depends.
It depends with the issue. I mean, with certain people, like there was a certain person that we wanted to cast and they were not really for it. And then we talked about it at length and they really listened to us. And finally, we got our way.
Mm-hmm.
And the person turned out to be great. So you just have to push for something you really believe in.
It was Channing Tatum. They didn't
want like,
him.
Don't know him. Don't like his name.
I am actually curious about like the real conversation that you had with Comedy Central when you're like, oh yeah, I can get Channing Tatum into our show.
Well, the surprising thing was we were like, we think we got Channing. Like he said he'll do it. And they were like, cool. But at the time the draft was like, I think it was like three drafts in and we did a fourth draft. But the third draft, they were still like,
the episode's pretty crazy still. Well,
they,
I don't know.
They said, like, they're like, it's a really basic premise. Like, they're fighting over a guy. And we're like, yeah, but it's Channing Tatum. Like, it's, like, the guy that you fight over. And they're like, yeah, anyway. And, but like,
and what we thought was so interesting about it, too, is more for our character specifically. Like, normally, these two characters would never fight over a man. So who could it be that would... that they would fight over, it would definitely be Channing Tatum. So, I don't know. But it turned out to be one of our favorite episodes.
Fantastic. Goodness. Sorry. Going back to working with Comedy Central, so this started off, you wrote this as a pilot. So the original plan was to go straight to television. And then it became a web series. And I wanted to talk a little bit about that process. Like, what did it mean to you to start off creating for the web? Even a web series under the Comedy Central banner.
Well, we came in and we pitched it as a TV show, and we had this like very extensive bible, and they were like, "That's really funny." No, thank you. And we had it so fleshed out, we just wrote it anyway. Just as we're like, this would be a good writing sample. We needed something to show to people, and we sent it back to them, and they were like. Still no thank you, but...
Because you were so interested. Here's what it looks like.
But we'll give you a web series, and I think that's how they're, you know, incubating a lot of shows now instead of doing a pilot, because you can see audience reaction, you can get further into the series. So we were really excited. I mean, for us, we just thought, like, we were just thinking, oh, this will be a great thing to have to show people what we look like together, like when we shop future projects. I don't think we knew it would get...
Yeah, we just needed something that showed our writing skills, our chemistry. Charlotte wants me to say, sexually. You know, just what it looks like when we write a show. We didn't have anything. We didn't have like any of our sketches online or anything. So this was like a good example of that. We thought.
Did audience reaction change the show as it went?
No, because we shot it all.
If you shot all together, but did audience reaction change the show from the web to then the television version?
Oh.
Well, it grew a little bit, which is good. Mm-hmm. there's a few more people watching. That was the biggest.
Did how they reacted to the web series change how we did the TV show?
Feedback you got over the course of the
no,
show.
No, we don't care about the audience.
Except for this audience.
I mean,
no. Yes, no.
We got a lot of positive feedback on the web series, so.
Yeah. I don't feel like there was like a crazy amount of who watched either. It was probably like 100,000 or something, which was great at the time, but like, you know, it wasn't like we had some like Charlie Bit Me YouTube followers.
Yes.
Thank you. I like that last laugh. Whoever had that. Cute.
Well, in terms of that, was there stuff that you heard like people really liked that they wanted to see more of?
Nothing. No. No, I'm sorry.
No, it's fine. You're being honest, which is what we ask.
It's true.
I mean, in terms of building in terms of building out the show, what do you think got bigger?
Physical bodies.
We did gain weight, actually.
We gained a lot of weight in the writer's
room. We gained a little bit of weight.
We actually did. We went back to like try on our web series clothes.
And none of them
shocking.
Fit. And then I cried, for sure. You comforted me. And you had the best advice, or not advice, but you just said, you know, so we're a little bit fatter. That's okay. No, I mean, changing it to 22 minutes from 5 minutes is a big change. You know, getting big guest stars is also a thing. Making sure that it's still interesting when it's mostly done in one location. There's a lot that we had to think about when expanding it.
What went into finding that location? Did you have a lot of different ideas and options, or was it like you just found that one house, you're like sold?
We I mean, we saw a couple, but that one stood out from the beginning. We wanted it to just look like a bigger version of the web series, and I think that's kind of what we found.
You know what's funny is that I think we always thought it would be pink, too, you and I.
Yeah.
For some reason, we just thought it would be a huge mansion that would be slightly pink. But that didn't happen.
I don't think there are a lot of really huge, slightly pink
mansions. I don't think there are, but that's funny that we both thought that. I just thought of that. Sorry, having our own moment over here.
No, it's all right. What would being pink have changed, do you think?
I don't know. It just seemed like a slight thing of like, Tansy lives here now. Like, just like one more hint of like, there was a woman's touch on it a little bit.
Sure. In terms of, in terms of like looking back at your own careers, I'm wondering, because we've got a bunch of actors here, wondering if there's something that you wish you had known back when you first started out, what would that have been?
How long it takes to, and how much work it takes.
True that, mic drop.
It's not easy, and it doesn't happen overnight. And even if you know one person that it has happened overnight for, like they're one in a lot. you have to work at it.
I remember coming out here and everybody was talking about how it was like, Ashton Kutcher came out to L.A. and he auditioned for That 70s Show, and that's the first thing, and he just booked it. Look at his life. And everyone being like, it can happen, like, right away. And I just remember thinking that. And it was so funny because, like, somebody was talking to me about how, like, if you're funny, like, you can't just walk around and be like, ew. Like, Ashton Kutcher has a look. You know what I mean? Like, I wish I looked like Ashton Kutcher. Ashton Kutcher. I just wanted to say it one more time. No, but it is. It takes forever. It takes so long. And some people will be like, this happened overnight. Or even we'll have people reacting to the fact that this is the first thing that we wrote together. I mean, we're very aware.
4 years ago.
We're very aware of how lucky we are that this is the first thing we wrote together and it got made. But it did. It took like 4 years for this to happen. Yeah. Like it was coming out and I was like, oh shit, our show's on. It's actually on. It just takes a really long time.
In terms of that, like even knowing that it takes forever, how do you make sure to keep going?
I think it's good to find outlets for what you specifically want to do and find out what it is that you want to do specifically. Acting is such a broad thing, you know, like finding Groundlings for me was like helped me kind of hone in on what I wanted to do. I think that that's helpful. You know, it could be like a certain studio doing plays, whatever it is, writing, doing the Vines, the Snapchats, the Periscopes, if you will, the Twitters.
She just found out about this today.
iPhoto.
iPhoto. No, iPhotos.
No, but just to find, you know, ways that you can express yourself and we'll help you.
Yeah, and I think the only other thing I would add to that is not making the one thing that you're going out for everything. Like, you know what I mean? Like, if you have an audition, sometimes it's like there's the one audition. And if I get this, it will change my life. But you have to just, like, I find that people book things more often when they have, like, two or three auditions of the day and they're just running through because they care less about it. A little bit.
You're so telling people to care less.
Well, I'm just saying, like,
no,
don't
I think
make
that's
it
smart.
Don't make it everything. Like, I mean, I see people get crushed by that, by making that one audition the one, you know. And so, I don't know. My advice would be to just sort of treat it like, yes, I care about this. Yes, I'm going to put in the time to do it, and then sort of forget about it and just like go do that. But then also have like a plan later.
Yeah.
So you're not just sitting around waiting to hear about something.
I feel like I've heard like producers say that that's kind of something they look for in actors.
Really?
Is like the person who doesn't look like they need it.
Yeah. Yeah. I feel like one of the biggest things of like when people talk to you before your audition, like, is finding to see if there's any red flags of like, oh, this person is freaking psyched about this. You know,
like the bad kind of sight.
Yeah, like I mean, happy to be here is great, but like people are like, yeah, can I just take a moment? You know what I mean? It's, like, it's a lot. Like, you have to imagine that they're sitting across from someone who's going, who's been acting, you know, for a very long time, who's, this is their 1,000th episode, you know, and then it's like this person is just like frozen because this is their moment. And just, you sort of just have to like let it go and just let yourself be a regular human being in that moment.
Well, especially because I feel like, especially these days, you hear more and more about how people prioritize likability in a new way. Like, people want to work with people who are cool. And, you know, that speaks to the fact that you guys do reach out to people you know already and cast that way. Mm-hmm. I don't really have a question there. I was just...
No, it's a great observation.
Yeah.
It is.
I mean, I'm glad you agree. I mean, but in terms of... And how do you... What if this is something you're really excited for? How do you tamp that down?
I don't know. Tamp is a great...
Just go tamp it.
Tamp is a verb that isn't used enough. And I would just like to say thank you for using it.
Props. Am I using it correctly?
How do you tamp? Yes, you are.
Okay, great.
How do you tamp down enthusiasm so you can remain cool and likable in an audition? Jillian?
I mean, first you have to say to yourself, tamp it down. and then second, you have to, you know, really just... Learn
and check in with yourself. Am I tamped down enough?
How do I feel? What's the level of tampness?
Regular, super, light.
Light. You're wanting a light in this situation. No, I think it's just what I was saying. Like, even if you're a writer, like if you have something that you're working on, we're starting to talk about the next thing that we're writing. We already wrote a movie, and now we're going to start working on our second movie. Next week. So it's just like moving ahead. Do you know what I mean? Like moving past something so that you're not just sitting around waiting for the phone call on that one thing. So that if it happens, great, your day is made, but you're, you know.
If you are really excited, you can also just like work on it, get that out, and then just sort of throw it all away. You know, like if it's something that's challenging, you're super excited, whatever, work on it, and then give yourself enough time where between that and going in, you just can sort of toss it off.
Everyone talks these
tamp it. Tamp it.
Tamp it, toss it.
Hashtag tamp it.
I booked like 7 commercials one year, and one girl like came up to me later who books a ton of commercials and was like, I used to talk about you in therapy because I would walk in and I'd be like, don't book me. I fucking don't want to be here. I hate being in commercials. It's stupid. And I just didn't, I like got to a point where I just didn't care anymore. Like I'd done it so many times. Kind of like, I'm saying the negative version of what you said positively, which is like, act like it's your 100th. But you know, but that is also part of the work of just like, get it out of your system.
And it's also
like, there's nothing to tamp.
Finding out what's going to help you through that. Because like, look, nerves are a part of it for sure.
Yes.
I have this story that I tell sometimes.
Jesus. This feels like something I'm going to have heard.
No, this is, you just have heard this is what I'm saying. It's lame. But I went to audition for Kirby Enthusiasm. That was the first job I ever booked where it was like a guest star. And I was so like, whatever, this would be cool to do. But like, I was just trying not to get in my head. And I saw every person from like Groundlings and improv people that I know waiting there in the lobby. And everyone was pacing and looked so freaked out. And I was like, I mean, I get that this would be cool if we booked it. Because you also don't know the, like, we didn't know it was a guest star. We didn't know it was a co-star or one line. Like, we didn't know anything about it. It was just, like, to play Larry's secretary for a scene or something. And I was up to go next, and then the door swung open after the last girl left, and I heard Larry David's voice, and I was like, oh, he's in the fucking audition. And I had no idea. Did I tell you this? I feel like I did. No. So I was like, this is why everyone is so panicked right now. And so I can either be like that and be totally freaked out and just lose my shit during this, or I can go in there and I can just say Larry as many times as I'm insecure, just say his name confidently so that it'll play it off like I know him and I'm comfortable with it.
Larry, 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 Larry.
You would
think. Larry. Oh, Larry.
Larry, Larry. Larry. No, but every time he would say something, I'd be like, oh, okay, Larry. And like, it just seemed like I was more confident. Because no fucking girl's walking in there being like, Larry, shut up. You know what I mean? Like, right. Every girl's being like, oh, like, you know, laughing at what he's saying. Because like, you know, and then trying to do their funniest like joke that they can think of. And so I was like, I'll just play like I'm super confident and then hopefully that'll work. So it's like, you know, just finding those things where it's like, what is going to make you less nervous in this situation?
I did the opposite where I didn't know that Julia Louis-Dreyfus would be in the room for Veep, and I like didn't learn the part.
Cool. How'd it go?
Really bad. And I was like, oh, good, you're here for this. I'll be looking at the paper a lot. but I really didn't know it.
What if you just went, Seinfeld woman?
But I should have not been like, nah, you don't want to see this.
No. And you just back out of the room.
I mean, how important is it to be off book for an audition?
Well, that's a good example of, you know, of...
That's a good example of a bad example.
Of figuring out, like, of learning what you're doing. And, like, part of the reason commercials are fun is it's improvised. It's one line. There's nothing to prepare. But when there's stuff to prepare, I'd say prepare it. Gems.
I'm going to take this one from you. Super prepare for it as far as like, well, and also you know the difference between like a producer session or the director session. If they're there, be off book completely. And know like the vibe of what you're going in for. Like if it's like, you know, if you're going in for like a Judd Apatow type comedy, you should probably be prepared to improvise. If you're going in for something where it's like somebody who's very known for their words, like Aaron Sorkin.
That's right.
Don't improvise. Say every word right. You know what I mean? But you like look up these people. Look what there's some writers that are very protective of their words is what I'm saying. So just kind of know what you're going in for.
Did you audition with Larry David in the Curb audition?
Yes.
How was that?
Great.
I just called Larry
him
a lot.
I just called him Larry a bunch of times.
Did they give you the scenario beforehand or they just kind of threw it at you?
No, you walk in. All they had said was you have to wear like a shirt that was cropped, shows your midriff. And I was like, oh, fucking, I don't want to do that. And then I was like, no, this would be cool. I should go do it and it'll be empowering or something or some jazz. And then is that a thing I say?
No. That's the only word we want cut from this.
Jazz. Did I say jazz? Cut that out.
Is that the weirdest wardrobe request you've gotten for an audition?
Probably not. I don't know what's the weird. Do you have a weird one?
I think the first commercial audition I went in on was for like to wear a bikini. And I would fucking never do that now. I probably wouldn't do any requests.
I can't imagine you do. And you have a great
bod. Oh, thanks.
I don't know why I looked at all of you to say bod, but she does. She has a great body.
It's true.
I like your body. Yes? I can't imagine you going to a bikini audition.
I was very young and foolish.
Is that something you think, you were ever thinking about, like, oh, I shouldn't do this, right? I shouldn't do this in case it haunts me later.
Do you guys have to go? Oh, I felt like you had to go, and I was like, you can sneak out if you want. Okay. Well, I've just been in that situation, so if you need to leave, don't worry about it. Sorry, your question?
was there ever stuff that you did when you were
where
younger?
Where are you going? Where do you have to go? Like, what's happening later?
Do you have an event later? An event?
Do you have something, like, what's going on?
Or is there something you could
ask? What bar are you going to? Yeah.
Tell
just
us.
Text us.
What is it? Yeah. 2.5 weeks ago. Oh my God. Is he here?
No.
Oh, so you were just telling her he's coming?
No, he's not.
Oh God, go! No, seriously, go, cause we're just gonna talk. And
you're not gonna
miss anything. I'm not saying it in a shitty way.
You're not gonna miss anything.
Seriously. No, it's great. Grab your bags. No,
tell him to tamp it down. He's tamping his anger.
I promise you, if you sneak out, it's not going to be a big deal.
Although it won't be sneaking out at this point because we've been talking about it and everyone knows.
No, no, we've been talking about it. I've done that look with my sister before where I'm like.
What was the look? I didn't see it.
I've totally done that before. And it's like, I'm enjoying myself, but also someone else outside is having has a different story. Sorry, what is this? I was going.
You're gonna ask?
I'm gonna ask a question. Okay. I'm distracting. I'm the cover.
Okay.
For when they sneak out.
Yes, yes.
Okay. So was there ever anything you did when you were younger that you looked back on and you kind of wish you hadn't done just because now it kind of haunts you today?
Okay.
Crack.
I like that you went. I like that you went cocaine and she went crack. Yeah.
Different drug tastes.
We're different people. Yeah. Hey,
it's essentially the same drug, though.
I had this one commercial audition I wish I wouldn't have done because I feel like that's going to come up at some point. Because it was on tape and I was dancing to
Did
Space
they keep
Jam.
The tapes of commercial auditions
I feel like they
years
do.
Later.
I don't know.
No.
But if they do, there's somewhere out there is me dancing to
Space Jam.
Everybody get up! It's time to dance now. It's got a real jam going
down. If they
down.
Kept commercial auditions, there'd be so much embarrassing shit about everybody.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, so I'm probably safe.
I mean, I just saw a video of Vin Diesel in like the year 1994 demonstrating Street Shark action figures at a toy fair.
Cool.
So I don't know. Things can happen.
Vin Diesel has a lot of great videos online right now.
He does.
He sings to Rihanna.
He does?
Yes.
See what you guys stay
See,
for?
This is what you're
We're
saying
just talking about
right
Vin
now.
Diesel videos.
Your boyfriend is just like, I just moved here. I don't know where I'm going.
Well, I'm going to do our last audience
yes,
question.
Perfect. Let's get it out.
Which is from Karen Summerton.
Oh, thank God you stayed.
You know what? I had.
Oh my God, it's all worth it.
Oh God, you stay. This is
all right.
Out. Okay.
Perfect. I didn't mean to
Let's
leave this for last.
Answer.
I didn't know you had somewhere to be. I'm really sorry. But this is a pretty
pass,
specific
question. Pass. Pass. Next question. I don't like the tone.
Okay. Karen Summerton would like to know, what advice do you have for a brand new LA transplant from NYC on getting a sketch pilot picked up here?
Pick up your boyfriend. On time. Or else.
Okay, wait. What advice do you have?
For
your new person from LA.
From NYC, New York City.
So I know
LA.
What that is. On
sure
getting a sketch
do.
Pilot
picked
up
here.
Here.
A sketch pilot picked up here. Take classes, mm-hmm. whether it's UCB, Groundlings, wherever, whatever's closest
Second
to you.
Second City,
boyfriend.
Iowa West, anything like that.
Get involved with the comedy community. Get to know people. I don't know how far along. Did you ask? Okay, I don't know how if you have a group or whatever, but like, just get to know all those people. Start working with them. Start taking classes. And unless you have a group you've been with for years, that's the case. Okay.
You guys have stuff online already? Cool. Oh, that's good. That's great. Well, I mean, and you have a pilot, so it's like 22 minutes. 12 minutes, great. Okay, that's a lot shorter and better. Because people don't usually watch things over like 5 minutes.
Yeah.
So I was going to say, like, keep writing stuff, keep shooting it, just so that
you
have
reps.
Stuff.
Reps. Try and get them to get you LA rep. That's the other reason school's a good route, just because you get seen by all the industry people. A lot of industry people go to UCB and go see class shows. It might be annoying, it might feel like a step backwards, but you moved. No, I'm just kidding. But just, you know, you can always try it, and if it doesn't work.
But it is, it's a good way to be seen, is, you know, you have these shows, people come out and see them, or you guys even, like, get a group together, you're doing a live show, and you invite a bunch of industry to come out, or people that you know out here that have, like, good agents or reps. I mean, that's all you can do kind of right now is
is sort of just get started.
Yeah, or perform. Welcome. Or if you're a if you're a sketch group, do live sketch shows. Comedy Central stage, you can rent. I think anyone can rent Comedy Central stage, right?
I believe so. Yeah.
And hound your reps to invite people to that casting or whoever it is. So perform live and do classes.
I mean, I think if you look at the current comedy landscape and everything that's on television right now and the amount of crossover there is between actors on different shows, I think it really speaks to how important it is to know people, because that seems like similar to you guys. Like that's how you cast a lot.
It's a weird thing to be like, oh, part of this is just make fans and not make fans of just like casting directors or agents. It's like make fans with the people you're working with. Be an easy person to work with and know what you're doing. Like if it's a play or something, be memorized, be off book, don't be the problem. You know, if it's
I just thought of another spot where you can audition. UCB has like a 6 o'clock spot where you can audition your show, and if it goes well, they give you like a little
spot?
Run. Yeah.
That's great.
So it's kind of like an open mic for sketch comedy.
Yes.
That's great. What other LA comedy scenes should people know about?
LA comedy scenes. What other LA comedy scenes are you into?
I realize now how silly.
It's a great phrase.
It's weird. I feel like those are the major ones. So yeah. I feel like those are the ones I know about. I mean, I feel like I don't even hear about like sketch comedy things that aren't associated sort of in some way, either at those theaters or with people involved at those theaters.
Yeah.
It's sort of like what people are doing. They go through. It's easier to get up on the stage, I think, with like IO West and with UCB than it can be with Second City or Groundlings, but they're great.
And UCB has like mod teams now, right?
Yeah.
Do they still have those?
Yeah.
Which are just sketch groups you can audition for. You know all this already. She's like, I know, I have to go.
I know, my voice.
Well, we're gonna make that possible now. I think that's enough for tonight. Thank you so much, you guys.
Thanks for
listening.
Thank you, guys. Thank you.
Thank you.